Good evening, everybody. Welcome back to Math Homework Hotline. I am one of your hosts, Maggie Mixon.
And I'm Hannah Hanna, everybody. Welcome to the Math Homework Hotline.
Right now, standing by are our teachers waiting for your phone calls. They are ready right this second to take any math question that you have on any topic. So call right now, 813-840-7260. And I'm going to tell you that for tonight, some of you have some of those geometry questions that's going to be the show on, as well as what we're doing here on the show. But I'm going to tell you, get all those quizzes and all those tests done right, because there's a lot of steps and you got to be really precise. So don't forget to call in, but also take us on the go on mhh.mysdhc.org. So definitely call in, get your questions answered, and be ready for all that great math work tomorrow that you're going to be showing your teachers that you know how to do. All right, what is tonight's topic, Hannah? So geometry, determine areas of triangles and special quadrilaterals, calculate surface area from nets and formulas, find volume of right prisms. With that, guys, there's a lot we're going to be doing tonight, but there's a special question that Hannah has prepared for you as his challenge question, and we definitely want you to be a winner tonight, all right? So pay attention just right quick, see what that's about, and then I'll show you all the great prizes that you can win by calling in.
Well, we do have a very interesting challenge question tonight, Maggie. And I hope our friends watching enjoy it and do it and call in with the right answer. The first to call with the right answer, you know the drill, will be our challenge question winner for tonight. Let's take a look at it. Yeah. It reads, given pi equals 3.14, calculate the area of that blue portion of it. Look at the drawing, take a picture of it, work according to your pace, because we're going to remove this in a second. I want you to take a picture of it and find the blue area, or the area of the blue region there. Let me just go over very quick numbers. The very base line, the base of this big triangle, is actually 10. Now, the height is showing on the side so that we don't distract the middle part of the drawing. This height is 7. Now, if you look at the circle there, the circle has a radius, and that radius is 2.8. We did not want to put the unit, so we did not want to make the drawing more crowded. We just want it to be as simple as we can make it so that you can figure out what you need out of it. Okay, one more time. The base is 10, the height is 7, the radius is 2.8. Work on it according to your pace. I hope you took a picture of it. And call us. What's the area of that blue region? What's the area of that blue part? Okay, you can do it. And I believe you can focus with us. We're going to give you little hints, Maggie and I, so that you can help yourself find the area of the blue part. We're waiting for your call. Back to you, Maggie.
All right, you guys. So these t-shirts are for you. By calling in, you can be entered into a drawing to get one of the shirts that says do the math with our logo on the back. All right, so just by calling in, you don't even have to call in with a challenge answer, but just by calling in a question, you can win one of those shirts, being a drawing to win. When you do get the challenge question though, right, you're gonna get all these goodies that are sitting here in front of me from Mathnasium, our sponsor, which we are so grateful for. Mathnasium has for you a wonderful assessment that you can go take at their center. Also, Minecraft, this is the Uno game, and then Canoodle, and all sorts of goodies that say Mathnasium's logo on it. So really excited, because you'll get a t-shirt as well, but you don't just have to call in with that challenge answer. So don't forget, any topic, any question, and you can also ask to be put on air with us on any of the phone calls that you have so we could answer it with you, all right? So really excited for tonight's show. I also wanted to give out a special shout out, though, to some special kids out there at Sulphur Springs K-8. They were doing some great math today, Mr. Hanna, on geometry, which was, honestly, guys, there's a lot of big word for a lot of different things. They were doing reflections on the x-axis and on the y-axis, and I told them I'd give them a special shout out. So in Ms. Boyd's period 7 class, I had Anthony, Lanaya, and Davion, who worked with me, and they were doing super job on that. So I told them to watch it tonight and see what they could do to answer some of these questions. I know you guys can do this. All right, special shout out also to last week. Another win for Barrington Middle School. This is their fifth week in a row for being the school of the week. And they had the most number of phone calls on our show, as well as Miss Garrison, 3 weeks in a row, who's been the top teacher who's had phone calls called in. And then of those calls, Jocelyn really impressed us with one of the questions that she asked. So even though we didn't have a challenge winner, we did have a great question that was asked, and we were able to select, you know, for her to win some prizes. So this is a show to turn in to get some prizes, get some t-shirts, and get all your math questions answered. Sounds like a good recipe to me, Hannah. All right, so we ready to do some math? I'm ready. I'm taking some of the things off of my area here so that we could see what it is that we're gonna be doing on this great board. So guys, what we're gonna show you is a lot of these different pieces of geometry. And if you tuned in with us before, you know that I like to start with the very basics, okay? So in some classes this week, they were just naming shapes. I know that you know how to name these types of shapes, but for instance, the square. How are you gonna make a square different than a rectangle? Knowing all of the different key features or different things that recognizing figures and representing them from other figures. All right, so how many triangles are in a square? Well, some kids will like to do something like this, where they'll say, Maggie, look, if I take a square, I remember different formulas based on the fact that I know that it's really two triangles put together. All right, so we got that down because I see that there's two squares here, which represented one of these guys.
And two triangles.
Two triangles, I'm sorry. They represented one of the squares. I'm gonna put that over here. This one though, each of the shapes is a little what? So this is a quadrilateral because it has how many sides? One, two, three, four. Quadrilateral means two, three, four, four sides. Quad is the beginning part of that. So it definitely tells you four. So being a trapezoid, what's so special about it? Well guys, it does have two bases, the top and the bottom. And it has a height. Now be careful though, because some kids confuse where the height is. And I like to tell kids, when I do anything that has two bases, and this trapezoid, I'm gonna draw it a little bit bigger. If you know this is your first base, and this is your second base, some kids start confusing some of the terminology, by the way. Little b is what we use to represent that base, but the height always connects the two bases together. So the height would be how tall this thing is. And Hannah was explaining that to you on the challenge question, that that outside piece of the triangle had been the height, all right? So the height, it's how tall something is, and we're gonna represent it with the little h. Now, if I put this back in here, I'm just gonna remind you that we could take the area of any of these, and area, anytime you do the area of something, you wanna think about a formula or a technique that you're gonna use, but I want it to make sense to you, okay? And remember that the units are always gonna be to the power of two. So this is what's called two-dimensional. Why? You're gonna take two dimensions and you're gonna multiply them together. For instance, here the area of a trapezoid, we always say is 1/2 base one plus base two times the height. Now this confuses some kids when they see a formula like this because they're like, well, where do I start? Well, first off guys, always start with your formula, plug in the information that you know, and then start calculating. But at the end, make sure that it makes sense. Remember that the units are always gonna be to the power of two. This is one dimension, this is a second dimension, and this is just a constant or a number. So when you multiply these together, you're gonna get, for instance, inches times inches, which would have been inches squared. Centimeters times centimeters, which would have been centimeters squared. When we do volume tonight, though, now that's not talking about two dimensions anymore. Volume, for instance, length times width times height. How many dimensions do you see there? Three. So now the units for that are always going to be to the power of three. So even if I don't list any units, I can always put the number that I get for the answer with the little u next to it to the power that it corresponds. Now this is an extension for when you first learned how to work with these figures back in elementary school, and you talked about a word called perimeter. All right, so perimeter, I can't just stop at area and volume. If this is to the power of two and these were to the power of three, perimeter is just a unit without a power. Why? Because perimeter is when I go all around the picture and I'm really just adding those different sides together. So when I add, for the triangle for instance, one side plus a second side plus a third side, I'm just gonna get an addition problem and whatever the units were just stay that unit. So if it was inches plus inches plus inches, it's just gonna be inches. or centimeters plus centimeters plus centimeters. I'm just reminding you what it's going to look like, what kinds of units we're going to use, and how it all is going to get put together. The last thing I wanted to show you was with these trapezoids put together. This is going to go back to the challenge question. I could have asked you something like, what's the area of the middle piece? So what would you have had to do for something like that? So what kinds of information would you need? I want you to be thinking about that as a hint or as a clue to how you're going to be able to answer that challenge question. All right, back to you, Hannah.
All right, Maggie, thank you very much. I hope we're all following what Maggie just said. I'm going to build a little bit on what she introduced to us. Here is one of these figures. Take a look at my board. You find a whole host of figures. This is Mr. Rectangle. This is Mr. Rhombus. This is circles, one circle, or Miss Circle, we can call it Miss Circle. Here is Mr. Triangle. Mr. Triangle, by the way, is a child of the parallelogram. And this is the very grandparent, or great-grandparent of all the quadrilaterals, except for trapezoids and kites and stuff. We're going to handle each of them very separately. But let me start very briefly with the easiest of all, which we see very often, and that is the rectangle. If I give you now this length as 20 feet and this width as 8 feet, I want you to find the perimeter and I want you to find the area. For the perimeter, you say, well, it's a journey around the figure. No worries. You just go around with your measure, and you go and add and add and add. Or, because these two are the same length, and these two are the same length, and this is a very common property of rectangles and parallelograms in general, then we can say, okay, if this is 20, I can twice this 20 plus. If this is 8, I can twice this 8. 2 times 20 is 40, plus 2 times 8 is 16. And now the perimeter is 56. 56 what? 56 foot. Foot power 1. And this is what Maggie mentioned earlier. You get the same unit as a length unit. And length unit has a power 1 because it's considered to be one dimension. What about the area, Hannah? The area, as this is twice what we call length, plus twice what we call width. This is the length, and this is the width. Now, for the area, you multiply the length by the width. That is to take the 20 foot, times this by the 8 foot. We shared with you last show how to multiply a unit by unit, as Maggie introduced. You multiply first the 20 by 8, and you get 160. Then you multiply the foot unit by the foot unit, and you get the foot unit to the power 2. And that is the area here, everybody. That is the perimeter, 56 foot. The area is 160 foot squared or square foot. What about a parallelogram? The parallelogram would always be, if I wanted to get this side, side 1, and side 2, side 1 here is the same as the one opposite to it, and congruent figures, congruent to each other, and side 2 is congruent to this one also. So if I give you this as a 30, say, yard, and this as a 10 yards, then to get the perimeter, you simply add 30 plus 10 plus 30 plus 10, or twice 30 plus twice 10, and that would give you 60 plus 20, and that is 80. 80 what? 80 yards. The same unit as the length of each side unit. Okay. What about the area, Hannah? For the area, you would have to initiate a height. And the height is, as mentioned, as Maggie mentioned, is the distance, perpendicular distance between the two bases. And it goes from one vertex perpendicular to the second one. What do you mean perpendicular, Hannah? I mean it makes a 90 degree angle, and this is a must. Otherwise, we cannot accept it as a height. Some students, by mistake, and I don't blame them, they don't watch math homework online, but you watch math homework online, so you have no excuse to mistake, okay? Some kids would do this, would consider this as the base and this side as the height. Wrong, wrong, don't do that. Never ever consider this as a base and this as a height. Yes, consider this as a base, but you don't consider this as a height. Why? Because the angle between them is not 90. What do you mean? I say, well, yeah, the base and the height have to be with a 90 degree angle between them. They have to be perpendicular to each other. So here's the base, what I consider base, side one, and this is what I consider height. And now area, everybody, is base times height. Hannah, if you want me to get the area, you need to provide the height for me. So let me provide the height to be 8 yards. Here's the height. Here's base one is 30, or side one, sorry, which is the base, is 30. So now to get the area, you do this. You multiply the base, which is 30, times the height, which is 8. Of course, this is 30 yard, 8 yard. You get 240 square yard, that is yard to the power 2. And this is your area, everybody. So perimeter, area, we're going to pass it on to Maggie. She has fun stuff to share with us. And then we're going to get back again and apply more of the other figures as well. Maggie, back to you.
All right, Hannah, thank you.
Thank you.
And I will tell you guys, that was a parallelogram, right? So we said special quadrilaterals. Remember, quad, 4. So with the special quadrilateral, the biggest thing to remember, yes, that it has those 4 sides, but again, does the formula make sense? Because we're trying to figure out, you know, what's the area of these. The next thing I have is a very simple picture that you have seen through a number of years when you were working in elementary school and you're drawing your little shapes and whatnot. So if you notice, it's a square. And I went ahead when you guys were working with Hannah and I measured from one corner to the other corner to see how wide this was. And it was 2.75 inches. Okay, so using my ruler, I got to measure that. Guys, things are not always whole numbers. This is actually one of the standards that we use in sixth grade when we say, wait a minute, we got to be able to even work with decimals, right? Now, being a square, I went ahead and I said, you know what? It kind of looks the same on all sides. So I didn't go ahead and measure. As a good mathematician, I would have, and I would have been really precise. But being a square, I'm going to go ahead and say, if I'm just kind of guesstimating here, all of these are going to be the same. So one characteristic of a square is that all the sides are the same. Okay, so what kinds of questions can I possibly ask you? So the perimeter, remember not to be confused with the area, is taking all 4 sides and adding them up. But what's a quick way to do that? Well, if each side is the same, can I just take one side and multiply it by 4? And the answer is absolutely yes. Now, in math class, you may call this the base, right? You may call this side the height. With a square, since they're the same, you could have just taken one of those dimensions and said 4 times b, the little base. Or would that have been the same as 4 times the height? Yes. So some of you are like, I'm just going to add them together, miss. Okay, but I'm going to save myself some time, and I'm going to say 4 times one of those sides is 2.75. If you notice, when I show you this math, I like to show you the way I would do it. I'm going to use a little x for multiply, since I'm already using a decimal, and I never want to confuse those. Remember, the multiply, you could use a dot for multiplication. So I'm thinking to myself, 2¾ times 4. And I know in sixth grade, you're not supposed to be using a calculator. So I talk to kids and I say, well, if you had $2.75 and then you double that and then you add those quantities together, like if you double it twice, how much would it be? So remember some good math skills, because some people don't think of it that way. They're like, that sounds confusing. Okay, let's just do it real quick. What's 4 times 5? 20, carry the 2. What's 4 times 7? 28. You had that extra 2, so that's 30. Put the 3. What's 4 times 2? 8, 9, 10, 11. Now be careful. If I were to say that $2.75, if I quadruple it, I multiply it by 4, I'm going to get 1,100. That doesn't make any sense, right? So look at it. There was 2 decimal places in. So that's going to happen here, 2 decimal places in, and it would look like $11. In reference to my picture, though, the perimeter would be 11 inches. If I were to have asked you, though, for the area, you'll see it sometimes as this, side squared. We talked about exponents last week. So side times side. Some of you that remember base times height, or some of us that remember length times width. I learned it this way. But does it really matter for a square? It does not, because the sides are the same, and that's why we could have done side squared. So for the area, I wrote my formula down. I'm going to plug in what I know, 2.75 to the power of 2. Now again, some of us are having trouble with this decimal multiplication without a calculator. Now even if you are able to use a calculator, guys, we want to make sure that it makes sense, that the answer is always what? Reasonable. And being able to talk it out and find your own mistakes as you've seen us do here on the show. 5 times 5 is 25. Carry the 2. Follow along with me. 5 times 7, 35. Add 2, 37. Carry the 3. 5 times 2 is 10. Add 3, 13. Again, I'm doing this for the sake of our friends who are still looking at multiplying without a calculator, and that do know how to need to know how to do this, which is a skill that we should all know how to do, right? I just used my first number to multiply all the digits at the top. Now I'm going to use the 7. When I use the 7, I'm going to start in that same place value. Okay, what's 7 times 5? 35. Carry the 3. 7 times 7, 49. Add 3, 50, 51, 52. Carry the 5. 7 times 2 is 14. Add 5, that's 19. So I'm done with that one, and now the 2. 2 times 5, where am I going to put that number? Underneath where this 2 is, I'm going to line everything up. Some people like to use graph paper when they have to do this as a way to keep everything lined up. 2 times 5 is 10, so I put the 0 down, carried the 1. 2 times 7, so I'm doubling the 7, that's 14. Add 1, that's 15. Put the 1 up there. 2 times 2 is 4, add 1 is 5. Now that I have that, I'm going to go ahead and add up all of those numbers. So the 5 was by itself, 7 plus 5. Now some people are still counting on their fingers, and you know what? That's okay with me. Some people do tally marks, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. All right, there it is. Carry the 1. 2 plus 3 is 5, add 1 is 6. This is 10 and 5 is 15, and that's 7. Again, if I'm looking at this and 2.75 times 2.75 and I have this big number, I know something's not quite right, okay? So how many decimal places were in from the end in? So that's 4 total. So 2 and 2, so I'm going to start here, 1, 2, 3, 4. So my number is 7.5625. Now if I was asked to round to the nearest tenths or the nearest hundredths, I would be rounding at that time. Otherwise, I can definitely leave my answer as that. Decimal is not terribly long, but now be careful. What's the area? Inches to the power of 2, because I multiplied inches times inches. So here, back to my answer, I would put that as 5625 inches squared. Now, the further along you get in math, though, guys, look at how precise this first dimension was. It was only out 2 places, so the precision was only to the hundredths place. So most likely, they're going to ask you to also do your final answer to that same precision. You can't get more precise than the original, right? So that would have been 7.56 if we were to round it to this value. Remember, you look at the number behind it, and that 2 tells the 6, stay. So it would have been inches to the power of 2. Long drawn-out answer to tell you, even with the square, even with decimals, it does get a little bit tricky when you're dealing with numbers that are a little bit bigger, that are not as comfortable as whole numbers. So just remembering all the good math that you already know how to do, and making little shortcuts in your head, possibly, for when you're given something like a square, and when we get back to my board, a triangle, you'll see that it's only half of that square. All right, we do have some t-shirts to give away, so really excited about Jordan at McLean getting a shirt tonight, and Natalie at Lutz, very cool Natalie, and Leah at Mann, congratulations. These shirts will be on the way to you, and your math teacher will give that out to you shortly. All right, back to you, Hannah.
Well, you read my mind, because I have put that triangle to share with our friends watching as the area and the perimeter of the triangle. What would you do if you're asked to find the area of the triangle? As she was about, you know, Maggie was about to introduce the triangle, but I stole it from her.
Oh!
Yes, here's the triangle, everybody. Let's take a look. It is a triangle, and let's take a look at my board. Yes, it's a triangle and a circle. And if you want to take this as a hint to do that challenge question, please do.
Okay.
Here, for triangles, we have to have two things in order for us to be able to find the area. One is what we call the base, that is from here to here. This is the base, okay, which we will provide. And second is the height. The height has to go from the vertex across from this base, perpendicular, and I said what perpendicular means a while ago, right? You recall it. And that is to make a 90-degree angle with this base. Of course, to draw an accurate 90-degree angle, we should have had a ruler and a set square, but I am just taking it very casual. But you know exactly that this has to be a 90 sharp, okay? Not 89 and not 89.9 even. It has to be 90 degrees. Now, with this being the base and this being the height, we can now figure out the area. Hannah, what's your base? I say, well, the base is, say, 16 inches. What is the height? I say the height is 7 inches. So what's the area? Here is the area. The area formula for triangle is half base times height. You say, well, where did you get that half from? I always do base times height. This is what we learn. I say, no. Watch. Why we put half? Because actually, this triangle is none other than half this parallelogram. You say, well, I don't see parallelogram, Hannah. I say, well, here it is. Watch. If I took this length of the base and I did a sister one here, and I connected this to this, this here to this here, what I generated now, I generated the very full parallelogram, half of which is this yellow triangle. What happens? Well, now this is a diagonal in this big parallelogram. And what does the diagonal do, Hannah? I say the diagonal connects two opposite vertices of the parallelogram. And it does cut this big parallelogram into two congruent triangles. What do you mean? I say, well, yeah, if you took this triangle, rotated it, watch. If I put here just a hint here, watch what I'm going to do. If I took this triangle, removed it, put it like this, and I rotated it, and rotated more, and rotated more, and rotated more, watch what's going to happen. It's going to be exactly congruent to the one other triangle, to the other triangle, which is to prove to you that this yellow is half of the very parallelogram, and the one under it now is the other half. And what did we say about the area of the parallelogram a while ago? We said the area of the parallelogram would equal base times height. So because the two triangles each is one half of this big, big huge parallelogram, then each area of them would be half of that. For example, if this whole parallelogram is 100 square unit, then this would be 50 square unit, this would be 50 square unit. The same unit, of course. If this yellow triangle is 50 square unit, then the whole parallelogram would be 100 square unit. You see what I'm trying to say? Because now this diagonal cuts the whole parallelogram into two halves, two congruent triangles. Each of them is half the area of the whole parallelogram. So with that being said, now we want the area of this triangle. Remember this, okay? What do you do? Hannah, what is the area now? I say, remember the half? Here is the base, which is 16. And here's the height, which is 7. What's half of 16, everybody? It's 8. And 8 times 7 would generate 56 inch squared. Area, everybody. All right? Area of triangle. What about the area of circle, Hannah? Since you're talking a hint for the challenge question, you need to give us the area of the circle because you're challenge question tonight had a circle and a triangle. All right. If I have this radius, which is the segment from the center of the circle to any point on the circle, if this radius is, say, 5 centimeters, or let's make it inches also, same unit, okay? If this radius is 5 inches, what's the area, Hannah? Area equal what? We say the area of the circle is basically this, pi r squared. What is pi, as the challenge question hinted to you? Pi, you replaced with 3.14, unless if you're told otherwise, okay? This is a deal between math homework outline and you. What is the radius here? It's 5 to the power 2. So you go 3.14 times 5 squared, which is 25. Or you can get your calculator and let the calculator do it in full, if you're allowed to use a calculator. So you go, you can go 3.14 times 5, and then press the square button, which is like this. X to the power 2. This is called the square button. So you enter 5, then you put pressure that, you press that square button, which is here, and now we press equal. It's going to give you 78.5 square inch. Now, quick hint, okay? If I have a rectangle, I'm going to give you just a simple, very simple example here. If I have a rectangle, and I have a triangle inside it, and then I got my color, and I colored all the region outside this triangle. Hint. And I said, and then I asked you to find the area of the purple region. What would you do? I heard you right. I can hear you from here, by the way. You can find the area of this rectangle by timesing length by width, as we did earlier. You then can apply the area of the triangle that I did a while ago and find the area of this guy. And then what? This guy doesn't have the color purple. So you want to take away this area of triangle from the whole rectangle, and this would be the area of the purple color region, okay? Did I say purple? Yes. Did I say blue on the challenge question? Yes. Is this a very sufficient hint? Yes. And if we don't get a color tonight with a challenge question to be done right, I'm going to be very, very hurt.
Disappointed.
Hurt to say the least, okay? I'm waiting for your call with the right answer. Please, don't let us down. Waiting for your call. Maggie, back to you.
And Hannah, actually, I think we should be able to start looking at the challenge question one more time in case you did not tune in when we were first looking at the challenge question so you can have a chance, especially
good idea.
Right after Hannah's hint for you. Okay, so what is that challenge question again?
Good idea. Take a look at it one more time. It says, given pi equals 3.14, calculate the blue area. And the picture says a triangle with a circle touching all three sides of it. We call it the inner circle, by the way, if you want to name that circle. It's called always the inner circle because all three sides of the triangle are tangents to it. Now, we want you to find the area of the blue color region, okay? Calculate the blue color area or the blue color region, okay? Find it out and call us with the right answer. Hopefully, you would be the winner for tonight. Before I leave the drawing, let me just review the numbers. The base of this triangle is 10. The height of this triangle is 7. And yes, I took the height out of the picture so I would not mess up, make it too crowded inside it. So I took that height outside, if you notice. But this is the same height as if it is dropped perpendicular from the vertex to the base, which is 10 units. Now, that circle has a radius, and the radius is 2.8. We avoided putting any inches or centimeters or yards or feet so that the drawing would be as clear as we can make it clear. Okay? Work on the area of the blue region, everybody, and give us a call. We're waiting for your call. All right? Back to you, Maggie.
All right, you guys. So I'm going to concentrate on things that have to do with squares. And last time we were looking at my board, we had here a square, and I had taken the liberty of, again, measuring one of the sides, and then I said, you know what, this looks about even, and I'm just kind of guesstimating here to draw a point out. Squares all have the same size. We got the perimeter by adding all the sides together. We got the area by doing side squared or side times side. It's how much fits inside of that shape. And we got this answer. But now, as Hannah had shown you, we could take a square and we can cut it in two, right? And make two triangles. I'm gonna put those back together. And then it would lead us into something that would look like this. Please do not assume that this hypotenuse, notice that this is a right angle, it's a 90 degree. So this here would have been a 90 degree side as well, or where the two sides meet is 90 degrees. This is called a hypotenuse if you're looking at right triangles. And you don't possibly know how to do this yet, but if you have two sides of the three, like I knew this side and I knew this side, I could find this with our formula called the Pythagorean theorem, which was a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Now, I'm not going to get into that right now, but I'm just showing you how I got this side right here. I told you I measured the one side and put it in for the others, but for this one, it was not a measured quantity. I went ahead and I figured it out by putting in the a and the b pieces into my formula. So anyhow, with Pythagorean theorem, I was able to find the length of that third side or that diagonal of the square. When I did the perimeter, again, I add all my sides together. I just wanted you to be able to compare the one to the other. Even though the triangle is half of this square, look at the perimeters. Are the perimeters half? Don't assume that, okay? So it definitely is not. Same thing with the area. So here, though, with the area, don't always assume. I just want you to make sure you understand the meaning behind it. With the area, though, that's a little bit different because if I'm just doing the area of half of it, it would warrant that that is half. Use what you know, though, and make sure that you can do it a couple different ways. The area of a triangle is 1/2 base times height. So again, if I know that this is our formula, I write it in, I fill in the pieces that I know, the base, the height, and then I multiply all that together. Now, some people get really crazy about a half. That just means divide by two. So I usually tend to multiply these two together and then divide by two. And if you notice that it is going to give you this, which is definitely half of that. So just looking for those patterns is what I want to get at. I want you to always connect the thinking in your head to make sure that it does make sense. Now, what's the next logical progression from a square? Now, a square is two-dimensional. So if I wanted a three-dimensional, remember that's three dimensions, meaning so far I had a length and a width, or a base and a height. Now I drew my squares, and the next logical step would be a cube, all right? So that it has a length and a width, but now this height is that extra dimension. Now what's so special about cubes? You know a dice, one of these little figures that we've been using on the shows as well, or a dice that you would throw when we were doing probability, like number dice, right? Those are cubes. Again, all the sides are the same. So the volume, how much stuff fits inside, if you will. So if I took this little guy, which is hollow, and I poured some water into it or some rice, how much would fit inside of there? So that space, the volume would be length times width times height. Now, what was so special about these? They were all the same. So sometimes you'll see it as just take a side and cube it, since these numbers would be all the same. So if one of these, you knew the length of that it was 3, for instance, or 3.5, because we were able to work with decimals, I would have just taken that and said 3.5 cubed. And I would have multiplied that 3.5 times 3.5 times 3.5, and I would have gotten my volume. Remember that my volume is going to be to the power, the units is to the power of 3. What I see some kids doing is they leave it, they get all this great math going, they find the answer, and then they cube that number. That is not correct. The only thing cubed for the final answer is the units. So let's go ahead and do that real quick. I am not going to show you the multiplication. Just do it on my calculator so that we can get to another example. And the volume would be 42.875 units cubed. All right, so remembering again, I'm trying to connect all the math for you. Two-dimensional to three-dimensional, all we're adding is an extra dimension of height, that tallness or the upward mobility, if you will. How tall that thing is that height. Like when I ask you, how tall are you? And you say 6'2". Hopefully you're not 6'2" yet, but that's your height. That's how tall you are. So definitely all these shapes have a height, and that's that third dimension that comes in. All right, back to you, sir.
Well, thank you, Maggie. We're going to visit another quadrilateral called the rhombus, right? The rhombus is the same figure that your preschool teacher used to teach it to you as the oval. No, that's not the oval, sorry. The diamond, I apologize. The oval is something else. That is the ellipse, in other words. But this is the diamond that you learned in preschool, kindergarten, as the diamond. It's not diamond anymore. Even preschoolers nowadays, they learn it the right way, which is the word rhombus, okay? Because they are so advanced because of the technology that they're exposed to. So with that rhombus guy, how would we figure out its area? By the way, it is a special parallelogram. Still, parallel sides, parallel sides. And this is where we came up with that word parallelogram, because every two opposite sides are parallel. But what makes this, that the rhombus so special as a parallelogram is that all four sides are congruent. All four sides are what? Congruent. Here we go. This is the same as this, same as this, same as this, for real. Okay? And one other property of the rhombus is that when you connect a diagonal, another diagonal, each one diagonal cuts it into two congruent halves. Also, the two diagonals together cut it into four congruent triangles. These one, two, three, four triangles are all congruent. Means if you put them on the top of each other, they would appear like one triangle, believe it or not. Not only that, but they would all be right angle triangles. For these two diagonals are perpendicular to each other, and not only that, but they bisect each other. This long one cuts the short one into two halves, and now this short one cuts this long one also into two halves. I'm just using any symbol to show you that these are congruent, these are congruent. Each of these diagonals bisect each other. And here is the idea where we used the diagonals to generate the area of the whole parallel, of the whole rhombus. Because if you take a look at this one quarter of it, it's a triangle with base and height. Half base times height would give you the area. Half base times height, give you this area. Half base times height, give you this area. Half base times height, give you this area. So if I get the area of one of them and multiply it by four, I will get to this conclusion that the area would equal. If I call this one here, from here all the way down, call it diagonal one, and then this one here, from here all the way to here, I called it diagonal two. Diagonal one, diagonal two. And it doesn't matter the exchange, no worries. I can call this diagonal one and this diagonal two. There is no specific label for them. So if I know the two diagonals lengths, I take this diagonal one length times it by this diagonal two length, and take that and take half of that. Half D1, D2, everybody, is what we call the area of this rhombus. So Hannah, give me numbers. Let me feel the problem a little bit more. I say, okay, here we go. If diagonal one is given to you in red as 24 inches, and now diagonal two is given to you in red also as 10 inches. Find the area, Hannah. I say, okay. If this is 24, this is 10. Sorry, this is 24, this is 10. We go half. We go half. Times. D1 is 24. Times. D2 is 10. And to process this, you have several several ways. You can half of the 24 and then multiply by 10, which I'd rather to do. Half of 24, everybody, is 12. Then 12 times 10 is 120. And 120 would be what? 120 square inch, whatever that unit, squared. Okay? The other alternative is multiply 24 by 10, which is 240. Then half of that is 120. Or you can take half of the 10 is 5. 5 times 24, guess what, is 120 also. I meant to do these three different ways to show you and to prove to you and confirm to you that multiplication is associative. Associative means it, the order of processing it doesn't matter. All right? You would end with the same result no matter what order you process the multiplication. First and second, then time third, or first and third, then time second, doesn't matter. All right? Now we'll leave it to here, to this point, and then we'll go back again to Maggie. She has cool stuff on her board. I see that net there. Did I say net?
Yes, you saw a net.
Okay.
All right, you guys. It seems like we're kind of getting ready. We've got the last 15 minutes of our show, so we got some more T-shirts to give away. Let me show you what that looks like again. These wonderful T-shirts are yours by calling in and being our lucky winner. Penelope from Barrington, Anai from Barrington, and Logan from Mann. So those, again, will be coming your way. All right, so yay! When we talked in the beginning of the show what the topic was tonight, we had a couple of more things we need to talk about. The word net, which definitely needs, is a two-dimensional pattern of a three-dimensional figure. I got that straight out of the textbook, our definition for that. All right, so guys, if you look at a net, remember I told you I'm doing everything with squares tonight. You always start at that base. Remember, and I always will say this, if you ever hear me talk about the base, Megan Trainor's song, All About the Bass, All About the Bass. Hey, I can't sing for nothing, but I can do this geometry. So you start with the base, all right? So with that base, now you know this is called something. So a square is that base. Hey, you knew I was talking about squares tonight. Square what? So if I were to take all of these triangles and fold them up, what would they all be doing? They would all be meeting at a point, okay, above this base. So if I had taken this one picture that was 3D and I flattened it out where you could see all the sides, this is the net that you would see. So that two-dimensional pattern of a three-dimensional figure. So it's a square what? It's actually going to be called a square pyramid, okay? I don't see a whole lot of pyramids around Tampa, but that's okay. If it was three-dimensional, the square starts everything off. I draw a little point. It looks like a hovering point, because I have kids ask me, how do you draw those? Then I take each of the corners and I build them up, okay? So if it was 3D, it would look something like that. Again, I'm not the best drawer in the world, but you get the idea that this is a square, then all the points meet at one, or all of the peaks of these meet at the one point. Now, how would I find the surface area of this? Now, surface area, remember, is just the surface area, meaning each of the figures, each of the shapes, has an area, and I'm going to take each of those areas, find it, and then add them all up. Well, for a square pyramid, if I were to draw those all separate, I have one square, one, how many triangles? One, two, three, four. So I like to show that so you could see if it was flat and I were to take all of these faces or all the sides off, you would have had these to build all of that with, okay? Now, do you have to find each area separately? Well, with this particular square pyramid, all of these triangles are the same, right? How do you know that? Because that square, doesn't a square have the same sides all around? Absolutely. So let's just do a quick example. So this one side is 4, means all of these are 4. So for the square, I drew all my separate shapes. I know the two dimensions are 4. What about a triangle? Well, a triangle, you know, is going to be 1/2 base times height. So what do I need to know for that triangle? So you look at the triangle. The base, you know, is going to be 4. Where, what's the height from the top to, again, that perpendicular height? We're going to call that 9.5. So this here, 9.5. And I'm going to speed it up so like that you can see the rest of this. So I'm just going to set it up for you, if you will. So 9.5. So 1/2 times the base times the height. Here, it would have been base times height, or 4 times 4, which would have been 16. I'll find the answer to that in a second. Now, what happened to all these other triangles? Aren't they the same as this one here? Absolutely. So when I find this area, I'm just going to take it and use it as the area for all of the others as well. 19. Mm-hmm. So, and Hannah found that for us, half of 4 is 2. 2 times 9.5, or 9.5 doubled, is 19. So then that would have been the area here, here, and here. The reason I like to show that, guys, there's a lot to do when you find surface area, especially when you have pictures that have all of these sides. So you find the area of each individual side, and then you add them all up. So 19 times 4, I'm going to do that real quick on our calculator, 19 times 4, and then I'm going to add 16. Hannah did that and got 92 for us as well. Now be careful. I'm still talking surface area. What did I just say? Surface what? Area. So the units, did I give you any units? No, I did not. So it's just going to be units to the power of 2. Lots and lots of work, again, to find surface area, but be very careful because you can make an easy mistake and you want to double check that all of the pieces make sense. All right, Hannah.
Right.
Challenge question time.
Yeah, we did not get a caller with the challenge question. I do not know why. I made it easy as much as I can and I gave a hint. All right, here's how you do the challenge question. Let's take a look. Okay, it is about a circle inscribed in a triangle. All right, to draw it by hand, I'm going to have to start with the circle first. Here's the circle. And then I'm going to draw the triangle as all three sides of the triangle are touching the circle. So here is one. Here's another. I'm going to have to do this. There's some art to it, a little bit of art here. You can just imagine this. And now we go this way. And then this way. And now we complete this part here. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what you saw on the challenge question. Was a little bit off here. All right, what we saw on the challenge question is, here's the blue region, everyone. This was in blue. This was in blue. And this was in blue also. Now, this base was given as 10. This is base equal 10. This height here was given as 7 from here to here. Make it a bit longer. This height here is 7. That's h. And now the radius here, radius is given as 2.8. This is r for radius, lowercase r, by the way. All right, how would you handle this, Hannah? Which I honestly hope that you have done it and called us with the right answer and became the winner. Okay, as I said earlier about the purple color region, I gave you a rectangle and a triangle, and I colored all this outsider part in purple. We do the same thing. We did the area of the whole rectangle, area of the triangle, and we subtracted the part that is not purple out of the whole rectangle. We'll do the same thing here. We're going to find the area of the triangle. How? That is half base times height, and I think earlier I showed you why we say half base times height, because every triangle ever is actually half of a parallelogram whose area is base times height. So the triangle would be half of the base times height. That is half times the base is what? Is 10 times the height is 7. I can do this different than the last time I did. I can multiply these. 10 times 7 is 70, and half of 70 is 35. No unit, no unit. So leave it. It's basically going to be unit squared, whatever the unit is. Okay, this is the area one of the area or the area of the triangle. Now I get the area of the circle. And yes, we can write the circle like this. This is the word circle also in geometry. The area of the circle would be pi r squared. What is pi, Hannah? It's 3.14, hinted on the problem itself. times the r, which is the 2.8 to the power 2. So you get your calculator and you enter 3.14. You multiply this by 2.8, and you go press that power 2 button, which is a squaring. The squaring button did the 2.8 to the power 2, gave me 7.82. Now, if I press equal, it's going to multiply that by 3.14, and it's going to give me 24.6176. I'm going to keep the four digits for a second. That is unit squared, or square unit, and that's the area of circle. Now, we need the area of the blue. To get the area of the blue also, we're going to change here into blue color so we can identify with the requested. Here's what we do. We take the area of the whole triangle, the big one, subtract from it the area of the triangle. Sorry, I take it back. I opposite it. Okay. We get the area of the triangle. We subtract from it the area of the circle. And that would give me the remaining part, or the difference between the two, which is in blue. So area of the blue region, blue part, would equal, you do the 35 minus, now I'm going to round this to 24.62. Why 2, Hannah? Because 7 is 5 or more. It makes that one become a 2. Everybody, get your calculator. Enter 35 minus 24.62. And that is none other than 10.38. 10.38 hundredths square unit, everybody. Whatever that unit is. Centimeter to the power 2. Centimeter squared. Inch squared, whatever the unit is, we'll take it and square it and provide it as the unit for this whole area. So basically, when you have difference between two regions like these, figure the outer, figure the inner, and then subtract. Don't worry about it. Okay? And now we want to send thanks and appreciation to Mathnasium. We cannot thank you enough for what you're supporting us with. And also throwing the call for everybody, if you have any business that you want to use to support Math Homework Hotline, we're here. We're waiting for your call and offer to support us. Mathnasium has been supportive, and we thank you, Mathnasium, for all you do for us. Now we're going to ask you to visit our website, as I always do. Check it out and check all the wealth of shows from last year's and even former shows this year, semester one and so. And try to study as much as you can. Prepare for the FSA coming soon, believe it or not. The time is running so fast. We're working together with you to make you the best performer on FSA and other exams as well. Good luck to you. Wish you a great, great night tonight. See you next week, everybody.
See you next week, you guys. We'll be factoring next week.
Good night.
Bye.